All right, I hope my voice is a little better than last week, and this is going to be my deep dive into episode number 6 of The Wheel of Time. I think I approached this episode with the incorrect hope that it would bring us a change of pace. It didn't. There was still quite a bit of dragging and posturing and ceremony. And I have to admit, this is driving me a tiny bit, up the wall. But let's start on a positive note. There are some very beautiful scenes in this episode, and the tension on the whole is palpable. It has been for quite some time. And also the opening scene with Yuan's backstory is pretty great. I loved it and it moved me close to tears, and I think it contributes to the world building by showing us a different part of the world where channeling is prosecuted, and it makes Xuan's appearance as the Emerlin Seed all the more intimidating when we get there. Great. Then fast forward, the council meeting, enter Loghain, and the first words from Xuan's mouth are a weird mix of physical kindness and mental cruelty. Let's take the shackles off, make you more comfortable, because we broke you already, you know. Second words out of her mouth, and for me the tension and magic are broken. Do you know why you're here? Seriously, it feels like a traffic police officer asking someone, "Sir, do you know why I pulled you over?" Only with less chance that the person you're asking doesn't know. He proclaimed himself the Dragon Reborn. He conquered countries. He gathered an army. He almost escaped the Aes Sedai custody, killing another Aes Sedai in the process, and he was promptly gentled for it. And you're asking him if he knows why he's here. Seriously. Loghain's pretty great though. It won't be much of a spoiler to say. I personally prefer the way his gentle state of mind is introduced in the books. It could have sent chills up my spine if the first we saw of him up close was after he was weeks, defeated, gentle, having spent all that time wanting to die and not being allowed knife to eat lest he hurt himself. Having a calm, non-violent conversation with a very quiet glint of madness intermixed. I think Alvaro would have made it fantastic. But I like his provocative defiance as well. I think I would have found it easier to be part of the Positivity Bias Brigade if I didn't consider the screen time available as compared to the story that needs to get told. The decisions about the pacing and the priorities and the choices of what gets included, I find it hard to consider them without thinking about what time they take and what gets excluded because of them. I think ever since the main cast was announced and Rosamund Pike was cast as Moraine, it was natural to assume that Moraine's part would be even bigger than it is in the books. Rosamund Pike is a fantastic actress with a ton of experience, and I assume it's easy to depend on her for a lot of the screen time. But sometimes I feel like this maybe is not fair to the story. Like, take this episode for example. There isn't a single scene in this episode without her, if we exclude Xuan's backstory. And we see a full hour with every aspect of Moraine's story, her interactions with every other character, her politics, her channeling, her secrets and personal life. And in comparison, we see, for example, two of the guys from the trio, 5 seconds average, misery and sickness in bed. If we had more time, I wouldn't mind so much, but with only 2 episodes left, I feel like I'm watching a D&D game with the level 19 spellcaster and everyone else is a level 1 nobody in terms of problem solving and what moves the story along. It's not far from the way things are in the books, since most of the characters are totally unprepared for the challenges ahead of them. But still, given how much of a driving force Moraine is, I find it odd that they give her even more weight and responsibility in certain cases. Like, take the Wiggates, for example. Why did it have to be her who opened them with the power? I know that channeling makes for pretty scenes, but one, this isn't the prettiest of them all, and two, I personally would have thought it better if we had a less flashy but possibly quite cute scene of Floyal fumbling around trying to figure out how to open it, mumbling something to himself or answering questions instead of the separate info dump he does. I'm sure they'll explain in the next episode why Moraine needed him for this, but it could have just as well started here. Another thing that I understand, but I'm also annoyed a little bit by the degree to which it's used, it's the rule that people use for most writing to show and not tell. Like, if I tell you Jonathan Lionheart was very brave, and if I tell you Jonathan Lionheart died saving his sick baby brother from a burning building, you know very well which of the two is more impactful and which is more believable and communicates better said bravery. And for screen, this is twice as important. Sentences like character X is this and that fall flat in dialogue sometimes, and that's why some of the comments by Steppen regarding Nynaeve and how stubborn she is, they didn't have much weight to them and sounded a bit off. The same thing could be much better communicated when Nynaeve speaks up to people of authority and refuses to let them sweet talk her or tell her what to think and do. And yeah, that's works out pretty great in the scene with Xuan. Wonderful, no bullshit Nynaeve, I love her. But sometimes I feel like Rafe and company are overdoing this. It's possible that I feel this way because I know the story, I know the world and the rules. So certain things to me seem unnecessary and repetitive. Like they show and tell again and again, just in different ways. Take for example the three oaths. First we see Moraine explaining them to Egwene. This is mostly telling, but it's necessary. And then we see Valda explaining them to Egwene. And as problematic as the implications from this scene are, at least it shows the practicality of the oaths. And now we see the oath rod whipped out for dramatic effect in a scene that, for me, is, despite the great acting, useless and illogical. We can see the oath rod in action and understand the mechanics of the oaths, but that's about it. And given the secrecy of Moraine and Xuan's relationship, and the pretend conflict, the intimate wording of the oath makes very little sense to me in front of all the sisters there. I think sometimes the showrunner's desire for darkness and drama pushes them to overdo certain things, and I think the scene with Moraine's exile is a prime example for that. It is painfully slow. We get tears, we get dramatic proclamations, we get the symbolism of everyone dramatically turning their back on Moraine as she drags her feet on her way out. Why? Why? Everyone tells us she's not really there. She hasn't been there much for the past 20 years. She hasn't made a home of it. Everyone points it out. So only Siouan, Lan and Moraine know that this exile means she's saying goodbye to a friend and a lover. For everyone else, it's just a different name for the same thing. Moraine's not there. Fine. Next order of business. Who's making persimmons jam? Right. Rant over. Some other questions and notes from this point on. If we assume the writers are being careful with what the Aes Sedai are saying in most cases, or at least in the important parts, why can't Moraine say what she's been doing during her travels? According to the oaths, it has to be true. So did she swear another oath that makes her incapable? And why does Siouan question it? She knows how the oaths work. If wisdom is the title you claim, then I suggest you start using some. Great line. Tough to swallow, but a great line. Why does Moraine twist the truth when Egwene asks about the boys? It makes no sense. She knows that Egwene is the one that trusts her most from the whole party. There is no need for this. The only consequence from this could be that if Egwene finds out, she would trust her less. Otherwise, she does nothing with the time she gains by this postponement. And yeah. There was a bit of uproar regarding the level of intimacy between Moraine and Siouan, but for me it's completely alright. It's suggested in the books and it makes sense. And Moraine going on your knees brings a nice symmetry to their interaction throughout the whole episode. I love it. If they stick with it throughout the whole Amazon series, it might detract from their separate arcs later on, but for now I think it's good. It's kinda sad that we get a bit more romanticized fish metaphors instead of vile fish-related swears, but I can wait. And the snap later on from Moraine about the only woman the Amerlin waits for is fun, because, you know, the Two Rivers gang get together is so sweet and corny and it fits them so well. After the past episodes, it's like I can breathe and relax for one moment, feel the love, and then the squabbling begins again. There's No Turning Back Now is such a gloriously unnecessary, overly dramatic phrase, especially at a time when you haven't yet crossed the line. If you jump off a cliff, then yes, there's no turning back, you jumped. If you're standing on the edge of a cliff, wondering if you should jump, there's totally turning back from that. And a pedantic enough person would do what Matt did just to prove that point. But Matt's not that person. So all I can say for now is I cannot wait to see how the story progresses and what they've got planned for him. I'd love to discuss theories if you have any. I know for now, at this point in his story, it's hugely affected by the fact that Barney Harris, who did a fantastic job with the role, had to leave the show. And I hope whatever the reasons, it turns out all right for everyone involved. So mostly I'm just keeping my fingers crossed. This video turned out mostly spoiler-free so far, but there are several things, changes and implied changes that I would like to discuss at the end of this. One, the oath. Given the way the episode went, I expect it might be relevant in a couple of ways. One, if Matt decides to go back there, she can't follow. And two, if Xuan stops being an Amerlin, she can still revoke the exile. But I still think it's extremely over-the-top scene, and I'd love to know if you have any theories about it. To Matt and his whole situation, I know it's mostly influenced by the necessary cast change, but I have questions and thoughts and wonderings. In a world that makes sense, Maureen would just open the door and drag his problematic ass back in. So I wonder, is Ma Qingxin going to attack them? Is some other disaster going to happen to stop them from coming back for him? Barney Harris is technically credited until the end of season 1, so I wonder if we are going to see anything from him. They don't make entirely clear the situation with the dagger in the Amazon series, so maybe that's on purpose. In the books, until the healing is entirely complete, he needs the dagger. In the series, they say if he touches it again, he would be lost forever. But we don't really know where it is and who's carrying it, what's going on. And otherwise, I would have guessed that maybe it was stolen earlier or that he felt some sort of pull from it that he couldn't overcome, because it's totally out of character for him. He is pragmatic, but he's not cowardly, and he would never leave his friends. I know the writers are in a tough spot, but I just need them to fix this decently. I hope they let Brandon have a say in here, because one, I love Brandon Sanderson as a writer himself. And two, I've read some of his notes regarding the Amazon series, and most of them make sense to me, so I would trust him to do Matt's character justice in fixing this. Three, and that's probably most relevant to the upcoming episodes, what the hell is Moraine planning? So far, the reasoning behind going to the Eye of the World is very thin. The justification is flimsy at best. They have been building this feeling of uncertainty and the sense that Moraine's plans are unraveling throughout the whole series, so in a way, this kind of makeshift whatever idea makes some sense, but still. Okay, Xuan says you have to go now, but just think about it. That's the Dark One, the destructive force of the world, evil himself. How weak does he have to be so that you can go there with a totally untrained dragon who doesn't even know who he is and what he is, and what, sneeze on the Dark One and defeat him? Come on. I'm much more likely to assume that the dreams are a trick and it's a trap going there. But it seems so obvious, I don't know why Moraine would fall for it. Then again, in the Amazon series, they don't talk much about the horrible dreams, so we don't get the same feeling from the books, like the Dark One and the Forsaken are in control there. So it doesn't look entirely that stupid to trust them. But also for non-readers, the notion of dreamers hasn't been introduced yet. So again, why would Xuan and Moraine trust the dream at all? I'm frustrated, fully engaged and determined to see as much of the story as they give me as soon as possible, but frustrated. And I'd love to read your thoughts about all of this in the comments.